Thank you. Teaching me anything that I know about this job, and to introduce the mentor of all mentors who is going to be running this show tonight. For those of you who've never been here before, when we have a roast, the person who is previously roasted has to run the next show. So I introduce to you Tim Harrison, who is not only ex-president of the Stockton Federation of Teachers, but is also now illustrious president of the New Jersey Council of State College Locals Upstate. one of our own. Are we surprised? No, not at all. So I'm going to turn this over to Tim. Thank you all for coming. I hope you have a fabulous night.
Good evening. Before we get started, I think you should also recognize and acknowledge Anne Pomeroy, the wonderful job she and her whole team are doing. It's actually amazing some of the things they're working on and some of the problems they're solving behind the scenes. And of course we're here tonight to honor somebody who has long service to our youth, Ron Chaplin. I'm not going to spend a lot of time talking about Ron because we have a large slate of people who are very eager to get up here. I mean, there are people chomping at the bit to get up here to talk about Ron, to roast him and to toast him. But I will say that the job Ron does is one of the most difficult jobs in the union. He's our long-term treasurer. The stuff he does is all behind the scenes. It's not seen often by the membership. And it's an incredible, to me, it's the one job in the union I would not want. The other jobs I'd be happy to do, the treasurer job, too much paperwork. All right, you know, like I said, we have a big slate tonight, and our first speaker is one of Ron's longtime colleagues, who I think I might have caught by surprise. Yes. Ron's longtime colleague in public health, Tara Crowley.
Sorry, because I'm shoving my face full of pie because I did not know that was going to keep her.
She wants to present and eat.
Yeah. I also brought my daughter tonight, and she was going to come up, but I think she's a little shy over there. So it's her mask that she was wearing, which won't mean anything to any of you except for the photographer of the shot, which is Jackie. It was probably the last time she saw my daughter is when she looked like this. And she's right there. Elle, will you wave? No. No. Tonight we're here to honor someone who is near and dear to my heart, Ron and his other half, Jackie. And, oh, wait, before I start.
I wore my jacket for you, Ron, today.
Because, you know, you never see Ron without a sports coat on. So I wanted to put my jacket on in honor of him. Although I have to say that you'd be happy to know that I bumped into him running the other day on the bike trail in Linwood. He was biking and he did not have his sports jacket on. The first time that I had met Ron and Jackie was probably, I think I was very large and about 9 months pregnant. I went to their house and in very much a Stockton fashion, Ron had invited several junior faculty from Stockton to his home for dinner that, of course, then his wife slaved away and made this wonderful dinner for all of us. I didn't think I would make it with my husband because, like I said, I was 9 months pregnant and actually overdue. I took a few things home from us. Both my husband and I took a few things home from that dinner. Obviously, one being a wonderful colleague who was trying to welcome us into their home and into Stockton. We also took a salmon recipe that, sorry Jackie, my husband has stolen and still pawns off as his own right now. But since he's not an academic, we will not chastise him for plagiarizing. I also found out what a wonderful baker Jackie is, so my daughter and I had baked for her. Since she's always baking for everyone at Stockton, we baked for you. But in the fashion of three children, it's still warm, so it's not even wrapped because we were doing it last minute. The last thing that we took home from that dinner, we always tell this story in our house. Jackie had told us how she had nursed both of her children. Obviously, both of her children are married and here now. For 2 years each. And I remember getting into the car saying to my husband, oh, that's so not happening. Yeah, karma's a bitch. So Jackie just wanted to let you know that not only did I nursed both my first two children for 2 years, but then throw in the third one, and sure, 3 years later, I'll just nurse him for 3 years. So 7 years later of nursing, obviously, I didn't know what I was saying when I left your house. Later on, after I had a few of my children, Jackie was so kind enough to come down and bring food again, and she took wonderful pictures of my children. Ron has a really, he has a great mate. Sorry, Ron. See, I told you it's the other half. I'm getting to you. But he called me up one summer and said, I wanted to talk to you. I wondered if we could get together. Maybe we could come down. So I'm thinking he's, you know, pardon the expression, he's pimping his wife out again here. He's bringing her photography, he's baked goods, and he's getting into my house. I'm like, sure, I'll make dinner or lunch for you if you're going to bring Jackie with you. So he comes down, and lo and behold, he came down to get me to be the holistic coordinator for the minor. So I think he had an ulterior motive there. So he used Jackie, got his way in, got a lunch, we got some baked goods again, some great pictures, and then there was a holistic health minor and new coordinator. So I guess it was a win-win for each. But no, I really have to give Ron credit, and I thank goodness that he has Joel, because I can't imagine what it's like to have be in a home with Jackie and Sarah, and then in a department with three women. The poor man doesn't get a word in edgewise at all. So we really have to give him credit that he sits and he waits his turn with three of us in a program meeting, eating his prunes, which maybe now later in life is, you know, has a second function. So I got you some prunes here too to take home with you. But when he does speak, it's like E.F. Hutton. We all listen because it's so few and far between that Ron actually gets a word in edgewise in one of our program meetings. So we are very grateful in our program that we do have Ron. And I have to say, all of the students, when they do their internship presentations, always, always, always say that Ron Kaplan, what we learn in his classes, we take with us, we use in our internships, but they always save their book, and they are much better writers after taking Ron's class. They might not enjoy it while they're in the class, but they definitely say after the class, they are much better writers. So on behalf of the Kachera family, all five of us now, two of us which are represented here, and the public health program, we are thrilled to have him as a colleague, an honor to have him as a friend, and I think that both him and Jackie are just wonderful people, and we are truly blessed at Stockton to have them. So thank you.
Wait, you can't go up yet. I'm so sorry.
And brevity is not my strong point, so I was trying to be quick. But Mary Lou Galantino cannot be here tonight. So she is at a dance recital. So when we were running on Tuesday, she asked me if I would read this, which of course I didn't even, I feel so unprepared with my students. I didn't even look at before I came up here. And to present this to Ron on behalf of the Holistic Health Minor. She writes, a tribute to Ron Kaplan. While I'm unable to present, unable to be present for honoring my friend and colleague Ron Kaplan, permit me to share a few words with my top 10 fashion of items that I am grateful for. Ron, I am grateful for number one, your tireless time and energy to our union. Number two, a warm welcome to your home for social events, even though I was oftentimes unable to attend. Three, your mentorship for undergraduate students in the public health program. Four, the commitment and dedication of our time in establishing the Stockton Holistic Health Initiative. Five, our times with Ken Harrison and the legacy of our publications to share the important message of holistic health and integrating it into our medical system. Six, your willingness to see the vision of Holistic Health Minor and your witness in its growth for over 100 students that are enrolled now. Seven, your dedication to the freshman students. They're eager to find a path in the wholeness. Your seminar is a foundation for the participation in the Holistic Health Minor. Eight, our connection through meditation and commitment to self-care. Nine, your assistance in highlighting self-compassion to our health fairs and our wellness day. And 10, the gift of giving with your warm hands. Enjoy a well-deserved evening in your honor, dear friend. With much appreciation and gratitude, Mary Lou.
Thank you, Tara. That was actually a lot more information about nursing than I was expecting. I was expecting a little. That was a lot, wasn't I? Yeah. Yeah. And speaking of some of the recipients of that nursing care, Joel, Ron's son, is our next speaker.
All right, I was hoping Sarah was going to go first.
So was I.
All right, Dad. Well, one way to judge success is by the caliber of the person's office. And for the past year or so, my dad has been very successful. He got a window. It's about time, but Dad, you finally have my respect. You're moving up in the world, but don't let momentum slow. There's so many other feathers to get in your cap. For instance, you want a super duper computer with two monitors. It's amazing how productive you can be with your email on one screen and calendar on the other for quick reference. Although in your case, you'll just want one large monitor so it's easier to see the fonts as you get older, and then a document holder to put next to it for your outdated paper day planner. Have your TA, do more of your grading, because you have many more important things to do. Oh wait, you don't have a TA. More important things to do, do you? Okay, well then, put a couch in your office so that you can take better naps. Oh wait, your office is too small. Well, maybe someday. I know you already take naps, but if you work really, really hard, perhaps someday your naps won't be on the floor. I'm so proud of you for the many accomplishments over the past 30 or 87 or however many years you've been teaching, and how now, finally, you will have some daylight at the end of your office to show for it. You may not know this, but while growing up, I was incredibly proud to tell people that you were a college professor. What an amazing job, I thought. I just imagined all of the infinite wisdom that you had, and I admired the students that you mentored and the minds that you molded. You helped shape so many lives, and I'm sure probably most of them for the better, and your students undoubtedly went on to graduate and do many great things that you inspired. What a fantastic profession that was earned by many years of graduate school and raw determination. As a little boy, I would think to myself, you are the smartest guy I know. Remember that silo thinking you're always making metaphors about? Well, now I'm all grown up and I see the full horizon. And you're clearly not the sharpest tool in the shed. Yeah, Dad. You know what I'm talking about. Remember? Smoke it. It was about the early 90s, and I desperately, desperately wanted a telephone in my room. Our house had a junction box in the first floor closet. So the plan was simple. All we needed to do was run the telephone wire from that closet up the attic and back down to my bedroom. Once you and Mom approved the project, I anxiously waited all week to begin. The weekend finally arrived. Mom went out to do errands, and you, Sarah, and I stayed home to get the job done. With a spool of telephone wire in one hand and a power drill plugged in to an unnecessarily long 100-foot extension cord bridging only 5 feet to the outlet, we got to work. With a sophisticated chorus of yelling to each other from different rooms and tapping on the floor and the ceiling of the closet, and Sarah doing something that we pretended was important to keep her out of the way, we figured out exactly where the hole should go. X marked the spot. And then we drilled. And drilled. And drilled. We kept drilling, unsure why it was taking so long to go through a meager 3/4-inch hardwood oak floor. you got tired, so I would take a turn. We handed the drill back and forth as each of us needed a break. The drill bit was glowing red hot. Of course, we were puzzled as to why this was so difficult. You'd say things like, "We probably should have bought a new drill bit. This one's pretty dull." Or, "Wow, that really is a hardwood floor." This was around the time that Jim Carrey's movie The Mask was popular, so we all took turns saying "smoking" as the red-hot drill bit basically burned a hole through the floor. After an hour or so, we finally made the quarter-inch hole that we needed. "I had full faith in your ability to do this project, Dad. You are my dad, and you could do anything," I assumed. So I never thought to ask if the drill was supposed to be in reverse or not. I should have asked. For those of you who know my dad's politics, you may not be surprised that the drill bit was set to turn left. Maybe the whole incident was part of a phenomenal lesson in politics about how difficult it is for the left to get through to the hard right. But politics and phone taps aside, you have always taught me that if you're gonna do something, you should do it right the first time. And if you don't know an answer, to never be afraid to ask someone who knows more than you. You live by this principle. So much so that I remember when your attempts to clean our shower tiles with conventional methods didn't work. You were relatively new at Stockton, but you asked the janitor what to do. You explained to me that he was a professional. He cleans the showers and locker rooms at the college, and he does it really well. So he's an expert, and you asked him for expert advice. It worked, if I recall. So your humility and wisdom stuck with me all these years. Now, if I ever need help installing anything in my house, I'm gonna ask Mom. Dad, you're a good man and a truly wise teacher of not only public health, but of life. You also teach by example about how to be a sincerely amazing dad. Thank you, congratulations.
Thank you, Joel. It's always good to get the insider's perspective. You know, as word of this event spread, a number of Ron's friends have come forward, again, very anxious to speak. We don't know exactly what they're going to say, but we have a long list of them. So first, tonight we have, from the friend category, Steve Shearer.
Sure.
Ron and I first met as a result of our wives being friends. Apparently, Jackie thought that Ron needed another friend, or at least a friend. And I understand now just why she would think that. Ron invited me to join a monthly poker game. There's no one else that I and the rest of those fellas would rather play poker with for money now than Ron. Not only is Ron a consistent loser, but he's a very pleasant and a very happy loser. And we all deeply appreciate spending an evening with him. My favorite moment last month was when Ron had to run upstairs and ask Jackie for more money. And that really happened. Are there any members of the administration here?
No.
On behalf of all of the poker guys, I'd like to thank you for giving Ron a paycheck, and giving us the opportunity to take our slice of that check on an ongoing basis. Last summer, I took Ron to his very first Phillies game. Does anyone know what Ron knows about baseball? Well, I'll tell you. No, Ron, it's not a stick, it's a baseball bat. Yes, Ron, they are supposed to run to first base after they hit the ball. And yes, Ron, we're allowed to boo. It is Philadelphia, you know. That is not to say that I don't learn stuff from Ron, too. I now dress completely different on weekends. Because of Ron, I now have a complete wardrobe consisting of only jeans and only old sport jackets. And politically, because of Ron's influence and wisdom, I've taken a big, big step away from the political center to the wacko left. And now politically, because of Ron, I now believe in exactly the same policies that I embraced when I was 20 years old and didn't have any money and didn't have a clue. It is very liberating to think like Ron. I can just imagine what you as his colleagues must talk about every day at lunch. So let's all raise a glass to Ron. Ron, it's been a trip.
Thank you, Steve. Our next speaker is another one of Ron's colleagues from Public Health, longtime colleague, Lisa Calvides.
Put my jacket on too, just to make sure I fit in, if you don't mind. I have to admit, when Mike Frank first asked me to say a few words at Ron's Toast and Roast, you can't hear me? Oh, sorry, I'm short. What can I say? I was just saying, when Mike first asked me about saying a few words at Ron's Toast and Roast, I thought, oh my God, now I know exactly how my students feel. I said, I really don't want to do this. I said, I'm not known for my humor. I'm not known for, and I said, no, I had to think of some excuse not to do this. And I had all this anxiety, and I said, okay, I know what I'm going to do. When I get there, I'm going to tell them the dog ate it, the cat ate it, it got lost on Blackboard, don't write it in APA style, can't use it. But I'm here anyway, so bear with me, folks, okay? Because I certainly didn't want to miss this at all. It's really hard for me, excuse me, to sum up basically 18 years worth of working together with Ron. It's been about 18 years, hasn't it been? It's been a long time. It was very, very difficult for me to put this down, so just bear with me. I guess the first impression I got when I met Ron back in 1994. Okay, I was trying to go by pregnancies and I couldn't remember it now. Back in 94, and it's one that's remained with me. The first thing that I noticed about Ron was he just basically exuded warmth, and he was very genuine, and he was willing to talk to people, and he was dedicated to his students and teaching, and he was always so enthusiastic with everything that he wanted to do, and to collaborate with everybody for the greater good, and that's something that has been consistent across the years and is always there. What you see, basically, I was thinking, is that what you see is total transparency. There's no pretense, no false image. All you get is genuine Ron, if you know what I mean. That's all I can say. In the years that followed, I don't think we've ever had a conversation together that hasn't been peppered with humorous one-liners and that lighten the mood, but also getting the point across very, very well. He's very reflective and has the knack for getting the rest of us to think before rushing into a decision. As Tara was alluding to the fact, he works with three women, and not to be gender stereotypic, but we'll sit there and talk, and Ron will just sit back and go, and say one or two things, and it pulls us all back to some types of sanity. He plays the devil's advocate, but is never the devil. He has wonderful judgment, but is never judgmental. He is short on words, but very long on thought. He is soft-spoken, but by no means a pushover. Ron's love for his family and his friends is always obvious. As you can see by the outpouring of people who came to pay tribute to him, he's well-loved and respected by all those who know him. Ron always speaks of his family with great pride, awe, and appreciation as he recounts their milestones. And of course, we're often treated to fabulous pictures taken by Jackie, which is wonderful. Ron's love of his family also extended to the four-legged variety. And to me, being an animal lover is a true measure of a person's character and makes them beyond reproach. Ron's beloved Max, I remember we met him when we came to your house and my kids were always playing with him. He was up on the bed and I said, oh, that's great. Anybody who lets their dog get on the bed is good in my book, okay? And I remember he used to bring Max to class and we always made sure that I knew that he was there because I'm a lab lover too. And whenever he asked about my kids, he always said, and how are your dogs doing too? Because he knows that they were like my kids. So that was great in my book. Ron's appreciation for the importance of the family in the lives of his friends was also very evident. I'm going to try and get through this without crying on. He also knows me. I cry a lot. I'll admit it. I'm the first to say that. As we all old-timers at Stockton know, life is long at Stockton, and experience we share together are very plentiful. During my tenure of 28 years, in my own life, I've experienced births, deaths, divorce, illness, and more accidents with my kids than I ever care to admit. The airlifts, the ambulances, and Ron's always been there. Too many of those to recount. Yet Ron's always been there to lend a very sincere, I'm gonna cry, I can see it. He's always been there to lend a very sincere and quiet ear and wise words of advice and solace just as needed. I know my life and my family are as important to Ron as his own. I'm not sure I've ever properly thanked you for that, Ron, so please accept my heartfelt thanks now. You've been steadfast in supporting me through all of my trials and tribulations, and more than the occasional frantic rants, which he's seen me do more times than I can possibly tell you. I know. I'm looking forward to another 18 years together, because as I've told you many times, you are not allowed to retire. In closing, and I think I've probably exceeded my 2 minutes, I'd like to thank the union for choosing to honor my friend and colleague. He's a wonderful representation of the Stockton family and is an extremely deserved honor. So, salute.
Thank you, Lisa. I think you really captured an important part of Ron. We have, Ron's sister couldn't be here. Ron's sister Judy couldn't be here, but we do have a video, hopefully.
Audio.
We have audio. Well, they're just
testing around.
Tell them when you're ready. Because I actually have a history with Ron also. I have a history, but I don't have like an epic history.
Talk about
now,
how funny it's been so far.
No, actually, Ron and I, for a long time, we came in a year apart. I think I came in a year ahead of you. And it's actually, I don't think either one of us would, we met pretty soon after we came here, and I don't think either one of us imagined 20 years later we'd be subsequent honorees at these dinners. When we met and interacted quite often at union events, the great tradition of our union is events like this, our payday parties. So that's something we never imagined. And then we were across the hall from each other.
Yes.
So I got to know Ron that way, a tradition that's going away at Stockton, unfortunately, as we start to compartmentalize people into departments. And I think there are some wonderful things about Ron, and there are some ways that Ron and I are similar, and some ways we're very, very different. And at one point, we taught a course together. We taught a team-taught course. There were 7 of us teaching. It was issues in diversity, and we each had a section. And I was one of the organizers of the course. And I'm kind of...
Ronnie walked over to...
We've got it.
All right. I'll save that for later. So this is Ron's sister, Judy.
My older sister.
Maybe.
Good evening. Well, my little brother has done himself proud. I am sure this will be a fabulous evening, and all of you should breathe easier knowing that Ronnie did not have anything to do with the planning of the meal. It may not be as good as one of Jackie's Roman banquets, but you will have better choices than the various versions of the dry granola on which my brother subsists. We also know that he is a numbers cruncher, no pun intended, and granola is cheaper than chicken or steak, and healthier too. My brother always had a particular palate. A wide assortment of foods were not in his genes. So he carried a bag of oranges around with him, everywhere, just in case the meal was not to his liking. We could not leave the house without Ronnie's oranges, which he entrusted to no one and carried himself in a little brown sandwich bag. Once he had his oranges, he would go out on the front steps and sit and wait for us to get ready. His fears were ameliorated. He was not interested in the rest of the process. Oh, I wish I could be present to witness his 15 minutes of fame, honestly. But the fact is, I cannot. Well, not that I can't, but that I choose not to. Actually, I am grateful that Ronnie is with you tonight, because if he is with you, I can enjoy my chocolate without any comments. About 35 years ago, I had a birthday party for my eldest son. The standard op is to have cake and ice cream, right? Well, that has followed other junk food, like quote-unquote hot dogs and hamburgers. Joel was at the party having a great time and was ready for some dessert. Ronnie, now you have to realize what follows was not meant to be a joke, but a genuine effort to change the trajectory of Joel's desires. Ronnie walked over to Joel with an apple in his hand. As I was handing Joel his cake, my brother, in all sincerity, asked Joel if he would rather have an apple than the cake and ice cream, as he had already had enough junk food. What planet was he on then? Was he tipping the juice? Thank goodness for Jackie, because Joel got his cake. All of these worldly concerns have placed a heavy burden on Ronnie, as evidenced by his thinning and receding hairline. He is happy, though. He saves on shampoo. He notices it. On another note, my brother suffered from a speech impediment when he was a kid. He stuttered. He did overcome this, but I am not sure his current challenge is any better, as he seems to have replaced it with his foot. My parents knew Ronnie as a dependable personality. As a girl, sometimes I was moody, hostile, or occasionally loving. Ronnie was the same old cerebral kid each day. He was a bit of a geek, but at least we knew he didn't have a split personality disorder. I mean, really, if he had a choice of a better one, why would he have chosen this one? When my brother was in college, he rode a motorcycle, much to my mother's dismay, I might add. He got it at a garage sale and brought it home in a box composed of hundreds of parts. Obviously, someone thought they could get it back together and failed. Each night, my mother prayed my brother would fail, but he didn't. Amazing that today he can't change a fixture, let alone change a light bulb. A lot of brain cells have died. Those connected with mechanical around the house. Perhaps you didn't hear this story. My bet is Ronnie didn't share it with too many people. When Ronnie and Jackie were doing their house over, Ronnie found a magic lamp. Really? He did. He rubbed it, and as often happens, a genie popped out. I can grant you one wish. If you could have anything, what would it be? Ronnie thought, I want to be funny. Make me funny, I want everyone to laugh at my jokes. The genie said, impossible, no one can do that. I don't have that kind of power. Your jokes are lame, they're old, and they're obtuse. Think of something else. So Ronnie thought again. He thought and he thought. Keep Jackie within her food budget for parties, decided my brother. The genie took a minute to think about that and said, what was the first one again? All kidding aside, my brother is the most honorable, charitable, and loving brother, and he has been my rock throughout my life. Through many challenges, always there when I needed him, and even there when I didn't think I needed him. I wish him only good things. And thank you, Jackie, for sticking it out. Congratulations, bro. I am so proud of you. I love you, Ronnie.
Sounds like a very smart woman. I wish she could be. Next up, we have another of Ron's friends, Joe Grasso.
Oh, he's not here.
He didn't make it. Okay.
Not that good of a friend, really.
Apparently not. Okay, so we're about a little more than halfway through our list of speakers, and at this point, we're going to ask the band to come up. They have a performance planned, and then when they're done, we'll get back to the speakers. So, talk amongst yourselves.
So nervous. She gets it from you, you know, right?
Okay. Thank you. Thank you to the band. Let's give them another round of applause. Let's have down as Ken. It's kind of funny being here because I didn't think I would do this. We were out to dinner a few weeks ago when Ron invited me to come to the roast, and he said, you know, you don't have to roast me, you could toast me. And I thought, a roast or a toast? What an easy question. He's such a nice guy, how could I roast him? And when I started thinking about how I would toast him, there's this little voice in my head kept popping up saying, roast. And I plan to toast you because I love you and you're such a great friend. But don't be surprised if things pop out. So just a few things to toast about Ron. First of all, of course, he's such a nice guy. But when he's playing poker, he'll stop at nothing to take your last 50 cents, even when you're down. He's always there when you need him, and he goes out of his way to help you, as long as you can fit into his schedule. He's always up for entertaining friends, as long as Jackie's doing all the cooking, and she doesn't tell him how much it all costs. He always has such nice things to say about everybody. It's just that he doesn't believe what he says. He's always willing to be the designated driver when going out for dinner. He just doesn't know where he's going. He doesn't have a problem drinking. Because he's afraid it might loosen him up too much. He offers the shelter of his air-conditioned home on hot summer days. But we have to schwitz because it costs too much to run the air. He's eager to go in on buying new household equipment that can be shared with his friends. As long as you leave it at his house. No, seriously, all kidding aside, Ron would give you the shirt off his back after he wore it a few hundred times.
Of course, these are all just jokes, and there are clearly very few who are more deserving of praise and gratitude than Ron. And I, for one, truly appreciate and cherish our friendship. So thanks, Ron, for being such a good friend.
Thank you, Ken.
We'll get him on the rebound.
Next up, another friend of mine. Apparently has a lot of friends. Robert Martindale.
No, Robert's not speaking.
Oh, he's on the list. If he's here, he has to speak. Okay, Robert's not speaking. So next up we have Ron's nephew, David.
As I was introduced, I'm David, I'm Ron's nephew, and my formative years were in the 1980s, when the economy appeared strong, computers weighed about 50 pounds, a healthier diet meant leaner beef, and healthcare nearly always involved cutting you open. Anyone who didn't see things this way was viewed, well, as a quack. Even as a child, without anyone exactly breaking the news to me, I understood that Uncle Ronnie was one of these. He wore thick glasses and had long hair. He ate granola. He actually traveled with granola. On visits, he would produce this giant plastic bucket of granola like a hippie feeding trough. And he'd offer it all around. No takers. But mostly Ronnie just went on and on about alternative medicine, which made everyone's eyes roll. No one even mentioned that he was a Marxist economist. I'm not sure anyone really knew. Years passed. I dropped out of Colby College looking for a bigger, less isolated school closer to family. Ronnie suggested Rutgers University. He sold it really well. A strong English department and a strong computer science department, the unusual combination that I was looking for at the time. Best of all, he was there. And if I moved there, I'd be able to stop in at his office between classes, he said, and we could have family dinners together. And it happened just the way he described for what felt like 30 seconds. But as you know now, Rutgers' loss was all of your gain. And I did eventually forgive Ronnie for luring me and abandoning me in New Brunswick, New Jersey. After my father died, Ronnie came to me and said, "I want you to know that you are not alone. I will help catch you and carry you through tough times like these. You will never fall past me." Now, he probably said these before he was completely established as in his academic career, and I should have thought, oh no, I'm screwed. But really, I did feel better. I believe then, and I know now to be true, that Ronnie means what he says. He would always find a way to help me, even if it meant making Jackie work 10 different jobs. He would find a way. I know this next announcement may surprise many of you here that know him, but Ronnie has ascended into the position of patriarch in my family. True, there are no contenders left, but it's still shocking. Yet he fills the role with leadership, empathy, and as much class as possible for someone with no fashion instinct and such a goofy sense of humor. To my horror, he has even become a second father figure to me, one who presents an alternative path to success to the one my own dad pursued. Ronnie shows through his own achievements that this path is long and difficult, but respectable and viable. As I approach what my eighth year as a PhD student. I look at Ronnie's life and think, I can still make this work. I can still be great. Thank you, Ronnie.
Thank you, David. Next up, we have my predecessor, is the Stockton Federation of Teacher President, my friend and my mentor in this position, and a longtime friend of mine. Well, I've certainly learned a lot about you I didn't know this year, I gotta tell you that. I gotta tell everybody, I am absolutely overwhelmed. What can I say about a man who's loved and admired by everyone, whose wisdom is legend, who's revered even by his foes? All I can do is start by saying he's not the man we are honoring tonight. Most of you know, I'm a psychologist, and part of my job is to study the human brain. And I can tell you that with most people, the left side of the brain does some verbal and sequential things, while the right side is more artistic and holistic. After knowing Ron for over 20 years, I can tell you with some great degree of certainty that in this case, neither side seems to do very much at all. Now seriously, with Ron, there's no middle ground. You either hate him or despise him. I don't want to imply that Ron is immature, but good God, the man can cuss like a 10-year-old. Let me say just a little bit about Ron's history at Stockton. You may know he joined the faculty in 1994. His degree is in economics. But for some reason, he was hired as an assistant professor of pubic health. Now, why do we even need a line directed at pubic health? And why would anybody want to work below the waist is beyond me. Okay, I found out it's public health, but the image of Ron figuring out a supply and demand curve on the pubic area still gives me the giggles, I gotta tell you. Now, on the serious side, as you may know, Ron has had some health problems. Nothing serious, but several years ago, he decided to work with a new primary care physician. And Ron got his first complete physical, and the doc told him he was doing fairly well for a man his age. Ron, ever the warrior, asked his new doc if he might live to be 90. And the doc then asked him a couple of questions. He asked him if he smoked tobacco or drank beer, wine, or spirits. And truthfully, Ron told him he did not drink any alcohol or smoke. Then the doc asked Ron if he eats red meat or lots of barbecue or a lot of eggs. And of course, Ron told him that he does not eat those things, but rather he has some fresh fish and lots of vegetables. And then the doc asked him if he spends a lot of time in the sun playing golf or tennis. And Ron replied quite truthfully that he only exercises indoors and wears lots of sunblock whenever he's outside. And finally, the doc asks him if he drives fast cars, gambles to excess, or has raucous sex with lots of women, and Ron shook his head, no. So then the doc says, well listen, if all this is true, why do you give a shit if you're gonna live to me? That stuff aside, I've known Ron, he's been a close friend for well over 20 years. He's a terrific guy. Ron and Jackie do live very, very well. They have two great kids. They have a passel of grandkids on the way. Sarah? He is a funny guy. He is charming and he is a truly delightful man. He loves his children and his grandchildren.
with all of his heart, but most especially he loves his wife. He is a good man, and he does have a wonderful sense of humor. It's a little odd, but it's wonderful. He has also served the union really, really well. He was a vice president for many years. He helped pick out some of the weaker people we have in the union. He was instrumental in selecting Sue to come on board, Sue Burrows. Yeah. He does take his work at Stockton very, very seriously. He truly does. He still works hard in his classes. He does do great work for the union. He does work that nobody else wants to do, actually, and he does it well. He delights in his students. He is a caring and effective teacher. He's a wonderful guy. He's a good friend of mine, and I'm absolutely delighted to honor him tonight.
Thank you.
Okay, we're coming to the end of our program, and we've heard all throughout the night about the women in Ron's life. We've heard from some of them, but we're about to hear from the two most important women in Ron's life, besides his grandchildren. First, we'll hear from his daughter, Sarah.
For those of you that don't know me, I'm Sarah Kimball. Yes, Dad, Kimball. Ron's only daughter. When I was told that my dad was going to be roasted, I decided I was actually going to say something, it got me thinking of all the wonderful memories I have of my dad. So I wanted to start this off with some of the memories of my childhood. Let's start off with all the fun games we used to play with my dad, my brother, and myself. First, there was a game we called Bye Bye Birdie. I don't know if you remember this game, but it always ended in me running to my mom crying. So in this game, we would lay out a blanket on the ground. I was the mommy bird, my dad and my brother were the baby birds. Sounds like a really nice, fun game to play. Not so much. My dad and my brother would constantly try to throw each other out of the nest and kill the other bird. And I would run to my mom saying that they weren't taking the game seriously. So looking back on this was probably not the best before bedtime activity for pleasant dreams. And then there was the Indiana Jones game. This was our favorite movie. Me and my dad would go to the park and play Indiana Jones. My brother was Indy, I was the damsel in distress, or for those who have seen the movie, Willie. And my dad was the bad guy. However, we only replayed one part in the entire movie, the part where the bad guy would try to rip out Indiana Jones's heart. So let me just paint this picture. Much like my brother said, kind of putting me in the corner, I would stand up at the fork, screaming, "Indy, cover your heart, cover your heart," to a crowded playground of young children and parents, and my dad would chase my brother around the park, trying to rip his heart out of his chest. So to sum this up, thanks, Dad, for all the seriously screwed up childhood memories. And I will be sending you the therapy bill and giving Child Protective Services your phone number when I try to teach my children these really fun games. I also wouldn't say I grew up in the strictest of households, and my dad was not always the best disciplinarian, to say the least. For example, when I was 17, my best friend Lisa took my car into Atlantic City. Went down a one-way street in the opposite direction, crashed, and practically totaled my car. My parents were, of course, relieved we were both safe, and obviously also mad at Lisa for taking my car and crashing it, and mad at me for letting Lisa take my car and crash it. So after careful consideration, they decided the appropriate punishment would be to ground us. But they didn't ground us separately and send Lisa home. They grounded us together. They sent us both up into our room and told us we had to stay there all night. So two 17-year-old girls hanging out in our room for the night. It really was a really hard punishment, Dad. So thanks for that, a good life lesson of how to discipline your children. And over the years, my relationship with my parents has changed. When I was younger and I needed to talk about my feelings, I went to my mom. My dad was always there for me if I needed help with schoolwork or picking out college classes or helping me craft the perfect email. This has changed a bit in my dad's old age. Yes, old age, Dad. Now if I need someone to cry with, I go to my dad, and he's right along there beside me, bawling like a baby. All in all, though, I made it out alive, and it turned out pretty well. My dad taught me how to ride a bike and was always there for me at my crew meets. He moved me from apartment to apartment and recently into my first home, and of course, walking me down the aisle a few months ago. When I met my husband, Jonathan, he would always say to me, "You and your dad are on the same wavelength. Sometimes I just don't understand the two of you." And in a lot of ways, we are. First of all, contrary to popular belief and what everyone has pretty much said here tonight, I actually think my dad's pretty funny. We definitely have the same sense of humor. And the best part about him is he thinks I'm hilarious. So we were definitely on the same wavelength when it comes to that. We're both our biggest comedic fans. There have been many situations when my dad will say something and I am dying on the floor laughing. And I look over at my mom and she's just sitting there shaking her head in shame at the two of us. The only difference now is normally Jonathan is looking at us right along their side or shaking his head. But in all seriousness, Dad, I love you. You've always been there for me and I couldn't have asked for a better father. And although this speech may have been more than a roast than a toast, as you know, over the years, I'm definitely better at drinking my toast than reciting.
Thank you, Sarah. And our final speaker before Ron's rebuttal is his wife, Jackie. Jackie?
Best friend for over 45 years, 37 of those as his wife. So I think I know him pretty well. For example, I know some of his favorite things. His favorite color is blue. His favorite singer is John Lennon. Sorry, Robert, but his favorite opera is Tommy by The Who. His favorite bird is the robin redbreast, or for that matter, anything with a breast. His favorite comedian is Rush Limbaugh. His favorite sitcom is Fox News. Ron has had some excitement in his life. He drove the wrong way on a one-way highway. He had a stripper strip while on his lap at his 39th birthday party. He became a faculty member in Stockton's business department for a semester. That was very exciting. And he changed the brand of his good granola after 30 years of the same breakfast every day. As in many relationships, we are opposites in many ways. I once wrote, "Dear Tin Man, may my love for you help to change your heart, as your love for me helps to make me smart. Love, Scarecrow." Well, it's no Steve Dunn, but it is uniquely ours. And through the years, his heart has changed, both physically and emotionally. When our children were born and all their life cycle events, he shed happy tears. Proud tears when he received an honorary doctorate in Chicago, and when he presented Joel with a doctorate at the University of Pennsylvania graduation ceremony. Sad tears when family and close friends passed away. Loving tears when our two beautiful grandchildren were born. And of course, he cried like a baby when Sarah got married, as he handed the check over to the Flanders Hotel.
I would assume, buddy.
We have different tastes in books, but we have shared some reading material. Starting way back with the book by Alan Watts, and The Prophet, Radical Acceptance, The Omnivore's Dilemma, The Girl with the Dragon Tattoo, and 50 Shades of Grey. Kind of like going from an intellectual spirituality to a dumbed-down sexuality, like marriage in general. Ron has always been very health conscious. Take butter, for example. We began our marriage using real butter. Then he read margarine was better for you, so we switched. Then a few years later, butter made the health news, and we switched back. back and forth for many years between butter and margarine. It was like a Parquet commercial. Then came I can't believe it's not butter, then the soy spread that tasted like butter. Now it's a non-soy spread that tastes like butter. Well, I married him for butter or worse. You know the song, The Wind Beneath My Wings? Well, I'm not sure which of us has the wings, but I know for sure Ron has the wind. You are the love of my life, Ron. I love you.
We've heard a lot of things about Ron tonight, a lot of things we didn't know. But what has most come through is that Ron is extremely deserving of this award, both as an outstanding colleague, as a devoted community member, family man, and as a longtime servant of the union. And we give this honor every year. The honor is called the Dusty Award, after one of our founding fathers, Ralph Bean, who's no longer with us. And it's my honor tonight to present to Ron this award. Come up. And I ask Ron to say a few words.
Speechless. I'm literally speechless. I can't find my speech. Thank you, Jack. Gee, it's really amazing how many people will come out for a free meal. Now, I know that many of you were upset when you heard it, but yes, this is my roast and toast. It is not my retirement party. So I will be returning to the college next semester. So I'm sorry to disappoint you. However, when I ask Jackie when I can retire, she always smiles and says, oh, in about 10 years. And she's been smiling and saying, oh, in about 10 years for the last 5 years now. Now, a roast and toast is like sex. I thought that would get your attention. Roast and toast is like sex. You can do it alone, but it's much more fun when you don't have to. So I want to thank you all for coming. I mean, for being here. It's been an honor and a privilege to serve as a union officer. I would not be standing here tonight if it weren't for three people who are not here: Paul Lyons, Dave Edmonds, and Ralph Bean. Yes. I was mentored by the best. From Paul, I learned how to be a better teacher and a critical thinker. From Dave, I learned that the most important thing that the union does is to serve its members. And from Ralph, I learned the importance of having a union and a little card game called Push that Ralph helped to invent. I miss all of them every day, and I think of each of them every day. I guess it's true that the good do die too young. And I'm not sure what that says about all you old people out there. They also say that behind every successful man is a strong, capable, and smart woman.
got struck by
yeah.
That was weird. They also say that behind every successful man is a strong, capable, and smart woman. But for me, this was definitely not the case. Most of the time, my wife Jackie was far ahead of me, and I was just smart enough to follow her lead. Thank you, Jackie, for your love, support, and your incredible good sense of direction. I would also like to thank the rest of my family and friends who spoke here tonight. I would like to, but I simply can't. What were you all thinking? I've never heard so many outright lies and distortions and exaggerations. They were truly shocking and misleading, to say the least. And if you believed half, even half, of what they said, you would leave here thinking that I was really some kind of a loser. Well, I want to just tell you all that in about a month from now, I'm going to the Caribbean with two women. Yeah, that's right. You heard that right. I'm going to the Caribbean with two women for 2 weeks. For 1 whole week. 2 women for 1 whole week. It's gonna feel like 2 weeks. So what do you think now? Pretty cool, huh? Well, okay, so their average age is 76, but still, 2 women. So in closing, I know those are the words you're waiting for. I just want to say that there is nothing like heartfelt praise and appreciation from one's colleagues, from one's friends, and from one's family. And I can honestly say this evening has truly been nothing like that. But I do feel very blessed, and I do thank you. I thank you all, and I hope that you enjoy the rest of the evening. Thank you very much. So I do hope you enjoy the rest of the evening. I know the big
right here, right here. We can't do the dancing too. It's too complicated. No multi processing on our part.
And if you're within 10 feet of us, you must dance.
Now I know what Robert and Ron really are.
I got beauty, I got candy, I'm a hungry man. I like to see what you were doing.